Hey everyone, welcome back to the GRE How-To Series, where we make studying for the GRE a lot more tolerable. Today we're going to talk a little bit more about probability, and this is really exciting to me because I struggle with it sometimes. Stay tuned. Hey everyone, welcome back. I hope things have been going well for you. For me, I've been really enjoying listening to Michelle Obama's Becoming. It's just kind of amazing to just follow her life and know all along like what's about to happen to her. Like, she's a young girl and she's going through a quintessential kind of Black experience, and it's just like, don't worry, you're gonna be first lady one day. And it's like, what? It's insane because it's just highly improbable. See, it's tying together. We're talking about probability today. But the fact of the matter is, it's like, even though it's improbable, it's just like, it's not impossible. And I find it so inspiring to listen to her journey, knowing what the end, as in, you know, what life now looks like for her. Of course, it's not the end, thank God, but just knowing what her future will hold really gives an extra layer of enjoyment, and having just getting a sense of like where she was in her 30s, and I'm in that journey right now, and it's just like, oh, I'm not I'm not weird. Michelle hopped from job to job, and she longed for purpose. So if you haven't picked it up or haven't downloaded it, I recommend it. It's pretty cool. No matter what your political leanings are, it's not, I mean, at least to the point where I'm at, I'm like chapter 15. I mean, it's not political. It's an American story. If you watched my GRE test reaction video, you know that for me, geometry and probability questions are not my favorite. So if you missed it, go up here and you can catch up. I really made a commitment to make sure that I put my head down and started to kind of understand how to break down probability geometry questions so that they weren't so foreign to me. You know, I think the thing that I've been enjoying with the geometry videos is that every time I kind of break it down and figure out how I should articulate it to you all in the video, I start to realize just how I didn't need to be afraid of that. And I feel like I had the same kind of epiphany with probability questions. I'm not going to make a habit of recreating a whole bunch of videos on math that, you know, there are a lot of great people like Khan Academy and things like that who have made great videos before. But one thing I can bring to you is just this real vulnerability that, like, sometimes I just didn't get it. So I hope at least if I can help you understand what I didn't understand before, it would be a valuable experience for you. So if you agree, give me a thumbs up. If you don't agree, give me a thumbs down. I appreciate the feedback no matter what. So when we are talking about probability questions, there are two contractions that we are they contractions? Conjunctions. Conjunction, junction, what's your function? Rewind. When we're talking about probability, there are two conjunctions that are mainstays in probability questions, and those are and or. First, we're going to tackle probability questions when you have to find the probability of two or more things, the and probability formulas. When we're dealing with and probability formulas, what's the probability that A and B happens? It's really one question you need to ask yourself first. And that is A independent of B? Let's say, what's the probability that it rains today? And what's the probability that my computer doesn't turn on? Raining and computers turning on don't really have much to do with each other unless your computer is plugged in outside for some reason, which is highly improbable. So we can really assume that these are independent events. So if they are independent events, then it's just a matter of multiplying the probability of A times the probability of B. So let's say the probability of rain is 20%, and the probability of my computer not turning on is 2%. All we're going to do is multiply 20% times 2%, and we will get the actual probability of both happening. 20 times 2 is 40. Then you gotta add that extra zero, it's about 4%. It's 20% times 2%, it's 0.004. Luckily, there is a calculator on your GRE test. Okay, so this is a teachable moment, right? We have a calculator in the GRE test. Use it if you're not like comfortable with mental math. And maybe you are okay with math, but you just need to see the numbers first, right? Like, write it down, count your zeros, and keep on moving. So don't let what just happened happen to you on test day. That's like a public service announcement. All right, so what we just discussed is finding the probability of independent events. Now, what if the answer is that they are dependent on each other? Let's say there are two reds, one yellow, and two green marbles in a bag, right? So there's five marbles. What's the probability that you take out one red and another red after, assuming that you're not going to replace the first one? The probability of taking out a red marble is 2 in 5 because there are two red marbles and there are five marbles total, right? Now, if I were to pull out that red marble, now there are four marbles and there's only one red marble in there. So step one was finding the probability of just picking a red marble out of the five marbles. We know that that is 2 in 5, which is 40%. Step two is trying to figure out what's the probability of taking out a red marble again, which is now there's one marble in a bag of four marbles. So now it's 25%, or 1 in 4. So all we need to do is multiply step one times step two. So all we have to do is multiply step one, which was 40%, times step two, which is 25%. That equals 10% chance that you're going to pull out a red marble the first and second time. Like, simple, right? I know that in the GRE, they're going to abstract it a little bit more and there might be a few more things that you need to keep track of, but the premise stays the same. You just need to keep track of what to do next and make sure that you're reading the prompt correctly to make sure that you're keeping track of, in this example, if the marble is replaced or not, because if you miss those details, you're going to get the wrong answer and chances are there are going to be trap answers ready for you to pick. So now we covered the two probability questions when it comes to and probabilities. Now let's talk about or probabilities. An or probability is something that's mutually exclusive. The classic example for these are using decks of cards, right? If the prompt says, what's the probability of having a ace of spades or a jack of spades, then we know that there's only one ace of spades and there's only one jack of spades, assuming that there's only one deck. So all we need to do is add up the probability of A and the probability of B. In this case, the probability of having an ace of spades is 1 out of 52, and the probability of having a jack of spades is 1 out of 52. So the answer is 2 out of 52. It's a beautiful thing. If the answer is yes, these can happen at the same time, then we have to think logically about this. If we want to find the probability of only one or the other happening, then we need to subtract the probability of both happening at the same time. That's all it is. Like, that's the craziest thing about math. Like, I feel like we should teach it more spatially and make it a lot more tangible, because once you start thinking about it in plain English or logically, it just seems like common sense, right? Like, duh, we only want if it happens in one way or the other way. If it happens in both ways, we don't want that. Exclude that from the calculation. So if we're trying to find the probability of a queen or probability of pulling hearts, then we need to figure out what's the probability of pulling queen card, which is 4 out of the 52 cards, and then the probability of pulling just hearts cards, which is 13 out of 52. And then we need to subtract the probability of pulling a queen of hearts, which is 1 out of 52. Then we get our solution, which is 16 out of 52. That's it. I mean, I'll probably be repeating this as I start discovering and getting more comfortable with the math and the GRE. It's all about just thinking through it. And chances are, if you're going to take the GRE, you're going to a graduate program, and graduate programs require you to actively problem solve. And often it's just a matter of thinking through the steps and trying to figure out, you know, what we can do with the rules available to us. I mean, that's absolutely what it is in business. And I'm starting to understand a little bit more about research and having that resolve to think through and try to figure out how you're going to present your topic or how you're going to research your topic is going to be critical for me and my sanity, mental health, and my success. If this was useful for you, please give me a thumbs up. And if you found value in this video, please let me know, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't subscribed. If you're a new subscriber, welcome. I always love getting those emails and you know, seeing that there's a new subscriber on the bandwagon. I want to be able to make a contribution towards you making your dreams come true. So feel free to drop me a line in the comments below on Instagram, Twitter, however you want to reach me. I will be there for you. I will see you next time. Bye.